So if you will just bear with me, the conversation really is around the topic of a promise to keep before dawn. And so this first story is a story actually that I've told quite often, and I'm going to continue to tell it because it is a sobering commentary of what is happening in America. And this story involves an 8-year-old little boy who came into my courtroom one October morning. In fact, I can tell you it was exactly October 8th. Because I had been on the bench exactly 1 week. I had taken the oath of office October 1st, 1990. And so this little boy comes into my courtroom and he stands in there, and it's a beautiful, sunny, bright, gorgeous morning in Atlanta, Georgia. And he comes into my courtroom and he stands there and he just starts to look around quickly. And then he stands there and he just starts to shake, as if his whole little soul was somehow being drained from him. I mean, he just stood there quivering. And so I looked up and I will tell you honestly that there was nothing in my legal training that could have possibly prepared me for what was going to happen that morning and a whole lot of days to follow the juvenile court bench in Atlanta, Georgia. This is the story. He had been dropped off at a homeless shelter on July 23rd by his mother, and his mother said, "I'll be back to get you," and she never came back. And so he was holding on to hope that somehow if he could just keep it together, that if he could hold on until he got to court that morning, that surely, surely, his mother would be there to claim him. And so when she wasn't there, that child had reason to stand there trembling that morning. Because I don't know about you, but I can't imagine being 8 years old and my mother saying she'll be back to get me and she never came back, and there's not an aunt, uncle, grandmama, cousin, nobody that you can just touch. And so I just sat there for a moment, not knowing really what the judicial response should be. So I instinctively just stood up. I just stood up and I started unzipping my robe and I started to come down, Paulette, from my bench. And the deputy sheriff stood there and he says, "Oh, no, Judge, you can't come down here." I said, "You better get out of my way. This is my courtroom and I have been a mama a whole lot longer than I've been a judge." And so I came down, and I literally got, after I had taken off my robe, and I came down, and I literally got on my knees so that I could look him in the eye. And I held him. And I said, "I'm not going to lie to you. I don't know where your mother is. But if you will just hold on, can you just hold on? Can you just hold on just a little bit longer? That I promise you that I will do everything in my power to try to find her. Just hold on." And so I turned back to that same deputy sheriff, who didn't work for me very long. And I said to him, you know, because you got to be right by children if you're going to work with me. And I said to him, I said, "We're going to recess this case. We are going to put it on my calendar this afternoon. We're not going to recess it for 30 days, 6 weeks. We're not going to even recess it for 1 week. We're going to put it back on my afternoon calendar today at 2 o'clock, and I'm issuing a warrant for her failure to appear in here." And he said, "But I said, nothing. With all the deputy sheriffs we've got in this county, we ought to be able to find her, or we ought to at least try." I set it for the 2 o'clock calendar. 1:30. They were walking up the front steps with her in custody. She had been home. She had been home sobering up from a crack high. I said, get in here. We're going to start at 2:00. I said, get us some coffee.